presenting on behalf of my amazing father, Sergio Salvo, who came to make it from Italy, very sad, and who looked this funny waterfall, my teacher and friend from the Hudson community up in the central coast of British Columbia. For those who are from Canada, we're talking about the west coast of Canada, kind of midway up. We're going to be talking about our work with the community on documenting observation of climate change and a whole kind of series of projects around that, which we're going to talk about today. Again, just to orient you, we're talking about the central coast of British Columbia. We're looking at a pretty remote area in terms of kind of how you think about British Columbia. It was recognized as the Great Bear Rainforest. It's one of the most untouched wild areas, if you can think about. Yeah, we put that in quotes, of course, for this audience and for others. The Heltzik and the Wikano and other folks have lived there for many, many thousands of years. You guys might have heard the big news flash about the 14,000 years of continuous occupation on Tricket Island in Heltzik territory and the Wikano territories. And they've obviously lived there well. They lived there with a very dense population and done it well. And how is it they've done that with kind of unbroken experience and interaction with the land through time? And actually through time when climate was changing. So it's really interesting what can we learn from the past and people's knowledge about their interactions with the landscape. So to kind of understand what people are observing in terms of changes to their landscape induced by climate change, so that's changes in both climate and weather, shorter term changes, we did interviews with 31 knowledge holders in the Heltzik community. And then we're in the middle of comparing these observations with other observations of climate change from indigenous knowledge holders from Alaska to Washington. And not surprisingly and frighteningly, we're finding lots of parallels up and down the coast. So what have we learned? Well, again, no surprise that people are observing lots of different kinds of changes in climate and that and weather, and that these changes are obviously linked to a whole variety of changes in when and where and how you find plants and animals that people rely on for their food and, of course, for all those other non-tangible things like identity, being Heltzik. We find changes about the ocean itself, like the tides are different, the storms are more variable, it's harder to gauge, all those kinds of things. And again, the things that we're seeing up and down the coast and in other coastal places around the world. So in terms of climate and temperature, people, of course, are noticing, as many of us have, that it's warmer. And especially during the winter, people talk about that there's just less snow. And people are looking out at that there's a lot of weather mountains in Heltzik territory and up and down the coast. And people would gauge the amount of snow in those mountains to tell them when to do what kinds of things. All that's dramatically changing. Because it's warmer, it means that there's more rainfall over the winter, and it's also we're getting drier summers, which have huge impacts on when we find salmon, where we find salmon, again, a really important food and a keystone species for the Heltzik. And things that we might think are, oh well, not such a big deal, but things like that people have grown up to know that this lake here was frozen, and that's where they went to play with their kiddos growing up, and it's where grandparents and kiddos hung out. It doesn't freeze anymore. So you've lost just kind of eroding away at those social connections that are so important for making the Heltzik the Heltzik. Changing snowpack, as I mentioned, and we have Pauline's voice here. Pauline couldn't be here. We had some problems with the video, so we'll just...
Well, unless others... 70 now, was just coming to me that there's snowpacks on these mountains. Mm-hmm. And when we were younger, the snowpacks were there almost year-round. And that so that would mean, a continuous runoff for waters, the water system. But the snowpack in all of the mountain range across from us completely melted, even sort of just probably by March, February, March. So there's definitely something that's affecting that and the cycle of rain. Mm-hmm.
So we don't get the snowpack, we don't get the runoff at the same time. It means the salmon just don't have the water to make it up the streams. They mill about, they're susceptible to disease.
about it. We're going to hear Pauline's voice throughout this presentation. Obviously, as I said, there's a whole range of changes in plants and animals. There is one of the observations that we hear a lot is that people are observing odd species, like pilchards that come from the south. We're seeing a lot more of them in the Celtic waters. People talk about deer, which is a really important part of their seasonal foods, that when there's snow on the ground, there's more snow on the ground, the deer actually come closer to the shore and they eat seaweed and when they're hungry, and then they're easier actually to interact with and to hunt. But of course, there's no snowpack, so deer are staying away in the forest and people don't have access to them, so they're missing a really important food in their diet. And also people are observing, of course, as people have all around this whole region, that the timing and the quality of berries is changing. Phenology is changing, we know that globally. So people would expect to see salmon berries at a certain time, they're not coming, and they're also tasting different. And that's something that people, again, are seeing up and down the coast. So let's listen to what Pauline says about that.
This is something that I've observed for the last 2 years, and I don't understand it, and I don't know if it's normal, but the salmon berries,
mm-hmm.
Normally the salmon berry bush will leaf, the leaves will come out,
mm-hmm.
and then the flowers, the little buds will come, and then the salmon berry flowers will bloom.
Mm-hmm.
For the last 2 years, the salmon berry buds have bloomed before the leaves have come into full foliage.
And the ocean, at least you mentioned, these are ocean people, the ocean waters are getting warmer, and it's been connected to a variety of changes, the algae blooms, there's more blooms. People remember worrying about red tide, which is the time you get paralytical shellfish poisoning. Shellfish, and if you talk to the old people up and down the coast, they say, there just wasn't as many when we were younger. Like, it just wasn't a problem, and now we get PSP blooms all the time. Herring or spawning herring, another Colpokiso species that helps it. People are noticing that they're spawning deeper, so they're harder to access. They're trying to find that cold water. Now, that might also be due to fishing pressure combined. It almost certainly has to do with where the food is as well. Let's listen to Pauline again.
Springs were very, very specific.
Mm-hmm.
And earlier I was telling you about the weather patterns associated with the reproductive cycles of various animals. And that we have the food harvest cycle.
Yeah.
So the spring, when the herring returns,
mm-hmm.
I call it our herring egg weather. Because nature helps the species to survive by orchestrating very specific weather patterns. For example, during the peak of the herring getting prepared for its eggs to mature to be laid, we have what I call very schizophrenic weather patterns.
Mm-hmm.
And it confuses people who aren't attuned, but one moment they'll have hail, and then another the sun will break out, and then and another wind will come up, and then it will be calm, and then we'll have rains, and then it will dry out. And so it was all of these various factors, weather factors, that come into play to assist in the maturation of the herring, because specific water temperature is required, depending on where they're at.
Uh-huh.
And so, in order for them to mature, they need specific, temperature. But all of the other patterns of weather can create ocean conditions that make it more challenging for predators.
Huh.
To get the herring stock. So.
And I should tell you that the Celtic are very actively engaged both with the ports and departments of fisheries, oceans, and in different kinds of communities. beneficial to the health of people for, well, we have evidence for at least 8,000 years, unchanged. And so there's this negotiation going on all the time about who gets to fish when and how to territory. And the elephant in the room is always kind of trying to figure out a management plan in the context of this changing climate. So Celtic traditional knowledge about where herring behave and how they should be managed needs to be readjusted, I think, in the context of this, as does Department of Fisheries and Oceans' set way of doing things. So sea level is rising. We see that's obvious. We know that that's a regional observation. We see from Alaska to California. The majority of the people we talked to talked about this. They talked about that when there's a high tide, it's much higher than they've ever observed. And of course, this has just really dramatic impacts on the village of Bella Bella today, where the healthy people live as their main village, but also a whole series of gathering and cultural sites, the clan garden sites that you've heard about up in Celtic territory. The tides are different around these, and so the relationship of clans, when you need a specific place in the other title, is changing. Archaeological sites, like those sites that you saw were occupied for 14,000 years, they're being threatened by the changes in the tides. And again, these are things that we're working with the Celtic to kind of help them understand what's up and to figure out management plans, and they're kind of figure out, okay, all the important cultural species and cultural places, where do we want to put our focus? So I just want to end with Colleen's wonderful words about the role of climate change and what she's observing and the impact in her.
We the Hessel have a word for the world. Mm-hmm. So we have a sense of another life beyond ourselves, another world beyond our own. Wakwi means the world at large. Mm-hmm. And we had an understanding of our connection to nature here and our responsibilities to maintain the natural order or to fit into the natural cycle of life and seasons. And we did that very successfully for thousands of years. And so as a result, we were able to sustain our lifestyle and our needs as well as that of other species around us, because we had an understanding of the complete connectedness. And we respected that. But it's not enough to just have a microcosm of people who do that when the world in general is not observing that and practicing that.
Well, that's fantastic.